Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of the Utah Stories program. My name is Richard Markosian. Today, a very exciting show. We've got for you Murder Among the Mormons, the history of Mark Hofman and his impact on the LDS Church, as well as the whole rare coin and rare book industry. It's a new film by Napoleon Dynamite fame director Jared Hess. It's a great Netflix film. It's doing well on Netflix. I'm happy to see that. Yeah, we're going to talk all about what's happened. We call this Small Lake City for a good reason. A lot of people cross paths with Hofman or his family, including my own family. My dad sold Hofman's parents' home. I have actually couple of things that they left behind the home when they moved out, including some pennies and a music stand. And my dad couldn't say more nice things about Mark Hofman's family, especially his father, just a very nice man. Just amazing that somebody would turn into such a monster. And we kind of go into that. How and why did Hofman become who and what he became? I mean, how does a guy become such a what appears to be psychotic, crazy person? But a couple of notes to focus on. Our new issue of Utah Stories is out and all over Utah, and this is our new issue. The cover's designed by Trent Call. Awesome cover. It's our health and nature issue. Mentioned a few stories in the last one. We're focusing on the Great Salt Lake. Paid a visit to the Great Salt Lake and got some amazing photos with my drone. It's still an amazingly beautiful place. It's not a cesspool. It doesn't need to become a cesspool. We can save this lake, but there's a proposal to build a landfill on the lake. There's a proposal to continue with the inland port and basically destroy the ecosystem of the lake by killing all the bugs, which all the migratory birds eat. It's a very important issue, and I hope you go pick it up. I'll talk more about this. This is also part of our Water in the West series that we've been doing for the last 6 months. We're basically seeing what we can do better in terms of our water policies here along the Wasatch Front and in Utah. So be sure to go pick that up. We have a visit to the Utah's largest medical cannabis farm. We have a story about recovering from addiction. And a story about a farmer in Moab. Lots of great content. Won't go into all of it. Story on Young Living Oils. And yeah, be sure to get it. And if you can't get it, then go on over to utahstories.com and subscribe to the magazine, and we'll be happy to send it to you. It's very inexpensive, $24 for the entire year. All right, so let's get right into it. So different from what you found from other podcasts or documentaries, we want to focus on Hofman's legacy, including this rare, interesting book that I bought a long time ago, Mormon and Utah Coin and Currency, written by a guy named Alvin Rust. I wanted to find out Rust's connection to Mark Hofman. Really interesting relationship here of those two men. This guy's son, named Galen Rust, was convicted of committing a Ponzi scheme here in Utah, and he defrauded investors of up to $150 million. It's crazy. This story is a lot deeper. But what I really want to get into is, what were Mark Hofman's motives? Why did he do this? How did he believe that probably he was doing something good? But before we dive in, if you'd like to support Utah Stories and our efforts to present you more stories, news, investigations to reveal the more significant cultural, political, and environmental aspects of Utah, hit the like button and consider sharing this episode with a friend. Okay, let's begin by showing a clip from the film.
The only way to keep a secret between two people is to kill one of them. It's kind of true.
The state of Utah has long been the home of the Mormons.
I love the gospel with all my heart.
They are driven by history, and they want to preserve documents.
Mark Hofman found document after document.
First editions, history, Americana, worth $1.5 million.
He was a rock star.
Religion sometimes breeds amongst people some extremes.
The first explosion ripped through a downtown office building, killing one man. The second explosion outside of...
Okay, that is the house my father sold of the Hofman family. So, very interesting film here, and I'm really glad it was made. Hollywood has not been producing a lot of great work, and Jared Hess produced one of my greatest films of all time, Napoleon Dynamite. We talked to the producer of Napoleon Dynamite a while back. But, so, this film has a lot of entertainment value. Of course, it has to. It has to be compelling and gripping, and it tells the story of Mark Hofman. But what kind of character and personality did Hofman have? He's such an enigma because he is a genius. He was the greatest forger of all time. How did he become such an incredible master forger? How did he set out on this path? That's where this book comes in Alvin Rust. It turns out Mr. Rust and Hofman had a relationship going back to when Hofman was just 14 years old. And Hofman became interested in rare coins. That was his first love. He was going to coin shows. He was going to Rust Rare Coin in downtown Salt Lake, learning about their coins. But he was also learning how to forge at that age. And his first forgery was actually given to Alvin Rust. And Alvin Rust goes into the back room and checks out this little dime he's got with a special stamp on it. And he does an analysis, and he comes back and he's like, you know, while this coin appears to be authentic, I found out it is not authentic. There's a little problem with the curvature of this stamp, and it's actually a fake. But feeling sorry for Hofman, Rust actually still bought the coin from him, and they continued this ongoing relationship through Hoffman's teenage years, where Hofman would bring him these forged coins over and over again. And according to Shannon Flinn, who's in the main character in Hess's documentary, these forgeries went on for years and years. And to quote Shannon Flinn, I quote, "The bulk of his forgeries were in coins, and probably to this day, 90% of them have never been discovered and never will." So these coins are circulating out there. There is actually a way you can detect if they're forged. You simply put the coin on a block of dry ice, and if there's a little part of the coin, the stamp or a mint seal, that does not appear the same color as the rest of the coin, then it's obviously a forgery. And so Mr. Flynn said, will coin dealers subject their coins to this test? And he said, no, they're not going to want to put their coins through this test, because probably they paid thousands of dollars for these coins as forgeries, and they don't want them to become worthless, so they don't want to test their coins with these. But that's where Hofman got his start in forging currency. And I'm going to refer back to this book at the end of the program. So basically, it's interesting because there's no school for forgery out there. There's no way a person goes out and learns to be a master forger. It's really through trial and error. And because Hofman had this great relationship with somebody who could detect and or authenticate coins and things of that nature, Hofman got his training in the coin business. So again, what he could do, he could take a $100 penny, and there are pennies, plenty of them out there worth $100. He could put a special stamp on it, according to Flynn, that would make it a $1,000 penny. He could 10 times the value of a penny just using a special technique that he had developed. He could do the same with a silver dollar. He could take a $10 silver dollar and turn it into a $1,000 silver dollar. And there were so many in circulation that they're not going to be discovered. And according to Flynn, you could give this test to a coin dealer with the pennies and silver dollars out there that might be in suspect, and very likely they will not do it. So next I want to talk about was Hofman a psychopath? What, how would he be characterized as a, as in terms of his psychosis, in terms of the derangement he had? I want to get into that, but before I do, I just want to tell you quickly about our three sponsors, that are helping make this show possible. They are Greenbike. Go visit Greenbike at slcbikeshare.org. They have electric bicycles now. And if you get an annual pass, you can go downtown, ride off of tracks, get an electric bike, and go all over town. You don't need to pollute the air. Really awesome what they're doing. They're changing the world by getting to more people on bikes. They have an app you can use. Just put your email address in here, sign up, learn about their different programs. You'll save a lot of money if you go from Utah Stories. We have a banner ad that rotates among here, and you can click on that banner and save money on your annual pass. The Utah Stories show is also brought to you by mrbeef.com/Utah Stories. Here you can save money on your first order of Candy Meadows grass-fed beef. There are a lot of people who, and I am one of them, who believe industrial agriculture, factory farming is not great for the environment. It's not good for you. It's not good for sustainable agriculture or the carbon emissions that that industry puts out. There's a lot of bad things surrounding industrial agriculture. Canyon Meadows grass-fed beef is an answer to all of the problems. They practice sustainable agriculture. They practice rotational grazing. Their cows are healthy. They remain on pastures their entire lives. And it is delicious beef. Good for you, good for the environment, and it has delicious flavor. Again, visit them at cmrbeef.com/Utah Stories. And then finally, we have Green Pig now as a sponsor of the Utah Stories show. The greenpigpub.com is Utah's biggest, best, baddest, most awesome bar for all your parties, events. Go there to watch a jazz game, watch the, you know, all the action, the sports action, and go there to have fun. I love the Green Pig Pub. It's just a wonderful place. Great food, great drinks, great people. Go visit them right in the heart of downtown Salt Lake City. You will have a great time. Okay, let's get back to the show. Was Hofman a delusional psychopath? I'm going to get into that right after this. Okay, now I want to go into the history of Hofman and answer the question, was he delusional psychopath? Because, I mean, I thought for sure he'd have to be a sociopath to commit these murders and to commit these atrocities and have basically no sympathy for the victims. But he was interviewed, according to Flinn, and evaluated by many psychiatrists to determine what kind of psychological disorders he might have. And according to Flinn, he was evaluated several times at the Utah State Prison. And while it might seem he must be a sociopath or bipolar, they did not determine that he fit inside of any of these categories. But moreover, he was a nihilist and a narcissist. He was an ardent atheist. According to his own testimony, he became an atheist when he was 14. Despite this, he served a Mormon mission in England. I find that interesting because he became interested in the early documents of the LDS Church there. England, as we pointed out in an earlier episode, was the main hub for finding Mormon converts when the initial church was founded. And as we reported in the earlier episode, it was the epicenter for conversion, including many of my ancestors. But Hofman played along and appeared to adhere to the faith, or so he made everyone believe. He married a nice Mormon woman and married in the temple. His earliest known document forgery was a document that added credibility to the church's stories. The golden plates have always been, let's say, one of the most challenging aspects of the church history. Whether or not the church, those plates actually existed, can be a sticking point for a lot of members who investigate the church. Martin Harris described the characters that were written on the plates as a form of Reformed Egyptian. And this kind of seems far-fetched because Egypt was a long ways away from North America. and the plates being written in Egyptian seems far-fetched. So Smith made his first forgery of these reformed Egyptian characters. Supposedly, these were copied by Martin Harris, and he authenticated the legitimacy by putting this little Mexican calendar here, tying in the Egyptian to the Mexican. The church bought this document in 1984 for $20,000. In today's dollars, that's something like $80,000. This set Hofman out on his path to, as Flynn described, become a rock star. I mean, he just was finding these documents one after another after another. And this set him on the path to create what was known as the Salamander Letter. The Salamander Letter was the most significant forgery of Smith because it had the opposite effect of what the reformed Egyptian characters had. The Salamander Letter basically created the idea that the a salamander appeared to Joseph Smith in a dream and presented to him where these plates existed, not the angel Moroni. And as Danny Stewart wrote in the story on our website, it's something of the occult. It's something of folklore. It's occult lore. Medieval philosophers talked about it in 1493. It's of all of these spirits called the fire kings and natural spirits. And it's a very interesting story. You can go and check that out. And but it really put the church and the leadership in a tailspin because they're like, this is probably a forgery, but then they couldn't discredit that it was. It was authenticated. He was an incredible forgerer. So in conclusion, Mark Hofman was certainly one of the most effective forgers and con men of all time. No question about it. He was a master at his craft, but he was also a murderer. He was a deceiver. And now he doesn't want to tell his story to the public. He's refusing, you know, to have recording devices or to go in front of a camera. Hofman has now been in Utah State Prison for 35 years, and he'll likely remain there. Alvin Rust, the author of this book, Galen Rust, was his son, who operated the Ponzi scheme, wrote this awesome addendum. Pointing out all of Mark Hofman's forgeries that were in this book, where he gave Mark Hofman credit in the preface. He thanks Mark Hofman for his diligent work and effort in helping publish this book on Mormon and Utah coin and currency. And here is the addendum pointing out all of Hofman's forgeries that are in just this book. All the pages, the figures. I mean, there's dozens and dozens of them. Since the text of this book is accurate, it's possible that in the future, authentic pieces could surface where figures are now forgeries. So he's thinking, maybe some of the forgeries will actually, authentic pieces where forgeries are now in this book will show up. And he says here, the experience I had with Mark Hofman was indeed terrible, but it will not keep me from trusting others. The study and collection of Mormon and Utah coin and currency is still fascinating, and it should and continue in the spirit, in spite of the Hofman affair. The identification of the fraudulent items pictured in this book will hopefully reestablish its credibility as authoritative research in the student collector. Alvin E. Rust wrote that in June 1988. And according to Galen Rust, Mark Hofman took his father for more than $150,000 on a forgery of the McClellan collection papers allegedly written by early Mormon apostle William McClellan. And Galen Rust, as I said earlier in the episode, was organized a Ponzi scheme that made he and his wife incredibly wealthy before they were caught, deceiving investors of thousands upon thousands of dollars. Hofman would never learn that setting up a good Ponzi scheme can be far more lucrative than the extremely laborious process of forging coins and documents. Galen Rust would learn this. But I've heard nothing but good things about Alvin Rust, I want to say. The original owner of Rust Rare Coins, from everybody I've talked to, he was a good man. So let's not let his son's legacy soil his reputation. But I think there's a lot more to this story. I think there's a lot more to this, because just this listing of forgeries, there's way more forgeries out there. These forgeries could be found. And would Utah coin dealers be willing to put their collections to the test? I'll have to get back to you on this. I know the coin dealers in Utah. I'll have to find out if they would. So with that, thanks for hanging out. Appreciate you watching. Again, head on over to utahstories.com. Subscribe to our digital newsletter. We will send you the voice of local Utah. We have an awesome open rate with this digital newsletter. It's like 40%, 30 to 40%. And if you don't open it, we actually automatically unsubscribe you. Awesome, great content coming directly to your inbox once a week. It is our main method of getting our voice, the voice of local Utah, out to you. So thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.